Okay, Chris Moore. Wow, I'm so glad he's okay. Been there. I have an ET slip in a drawer in there for 163 miles an hour. Just my body. Bike never made it. It went out over the rails and into the field. And now he explained what happened to his crash. And now something that I discovered makes sense. I didn't put it together, and I'm probably damn lucky that I didn't end up like Chris Moore. He went through the finish line at 192 miles an hour, which I exceed on a regular basis, and the right side of his fairing blew off. And of course, aerodynamics being what it is, there was now a suction on that side of the bike. And it pulled his handlebars to the right, to the wheel lock, and slammed him to the ground, left side. So when I was making we were trying to find an empty spot in the freeway. It had to be empty. We weren't going to do it unless we could see for 2 miles this way and 2 miles that way, and that there was no traffic, zero. Otherwise, we just weren't going to do it. And a few practice runs, just right around the 190, 200 mile per hour mark, when I would get the bike packed to the shop. This was not Dirty Girl or Blue Boy or any of the cut race bikes. This was a factory stock. Other than the engine, the exterior wheels, wheel length, everything was stock. So you see, all of my drag bikes, all the fairings were all modified, especially Dirty Girl, the green bike. Okay. That had extra braces added because when I did the carbon fiber, I added extra 90 degree bend aluminum braces were glued in there. Okay. All the aluminum struts, because I built airplanes, I put ribs in there. And I think that's probably why that bike was safe. The white Busa, I got it back to the shop one evening after doing some test passes there. And the bolts had wiggled back and forth and had made the hole bigger. I could tell something was going seriously wrong there. Okay. I drill and tapped every single exterior screw on that, okay, to 1 millimeter up larger. And now I understand why. Because the front of that bike was about to come off. And I'm just so grateful it didn't happen. Now that I understand what was going on and why those holes were wearing the way they were. Yeah, 'cause see, the bike felt incredibly smooth at those speeds. As soon as you got over 185, 190 miles an hour, the wind went from here at the windshield up and over, and all of a sudden the bike got quiet. Everything got smoother. It quit buffeting and all of those things, okay? But it was getting there. And so I think Chris didn't notice that he was starting to get deformation in the holes. And boom, you go down. I'm so glad he's okay. 192 miles an hour. It just goes to show you, wear all of your safety gear all of the time. So I'm in Redding. I'm at the drag strip. It's 104 degrees, and I'm in full fucking leathers, helmet, gloves, hard boots, because I broke both my ankles wearing soft boots, military Air Force issue boots during a crash. I decided from that point on I was going to wear hard boots. Okay. And man, yeah. You see the tumbling. Wear all of your safety gear all of the time. If you're going to get off the bike, if you have to get off the bike, then you need to slide, which means you're going to need quality leathers, not some cheap fucking pair of Levi's and a leather jacket. That ain't going to cut it, my friend. Same thing with the gloves. You need carbon fiber palm, carbon fiber knuckles, carbon fiber fingertip. You need the safety gloves and not just gloves, okay? So that when you have to get off at a high rate of speed, you can literally slide down the street. So I didn't get hurt. 163 miles an hour. I was sore. I had a couple of bruises, but I was young. You know what I mean? I was young. Yeah. That explains it. That explains the deformations. And he probably had some and didn't notice it. And it doesn't take much. And he didn't have any safety struts in there like I didn't on the white bike. And now I would recommend anybody that's going to put more horsepower in their Hayabusa, if they want to start going 200 plus miles an hour, I suggest you pull those, that front fairing off, and put braces everywhere. You see, I had to do it on the drag bike because I had to compromise the front fascia of the bike because I cut holes in it for the exhaust, cut holes in it for turbos, cut holes, cut holes, cut holes. And so that I just reinforced everything with struts. What I did was I used a carbon fiber glue and I drilled holes all the way down the face of the aluminum so that the glue would squeeze out above that. And then I smeared it all down and laid a strip of carbon fiber in there. Okay. It kind of worked like fiberglass because I didn't have an autoclave to put it in there and properly cure everything. But the glue did cure, and it was extremely stiff. The stock one I could pick up, and it would wobbly. After I was done, it was a solid unit. And the nice thing about that is when I put it on, every single fucking hole lined up exactly perfectly every single time. So, yeah, I'm kind of surprised. Suzuki should be aware of this, that the front of the bikes can fail and that fairing can blow in half and it can throw you down. And I'm starting to think that maybe some of the unexplained accidents that I've heard of on Hayabusas doing high-speed runs, that that's what happened. And that when they went down and collected the body, the parts were everywhere and they didn't put it together. Chris Moore was on a drag strip, nothing to run into. It failed. It threw him to the concrete. He slid. He got road rash up the fucking ass, which I've lived through. Absolutely horrifying. I'd rather break bones than have my skin ground down. See the fake knuckle in there? That was ground all the way down to the fucking bone. Man, it hurt. All of my fingers, you can see how they look weird up here at the top. See that? How they wrinkle up. That was my fingers, basically all of my knuckles and my little finger down here. Those were all ground down to the bone, and that's why they look like that. Road rash sucks. Okay, so anyway, that explains it. That explains it. And some of the mysteries that I've heard about Hayabusa crashes where they just went down for an unknown reason. That I think that kind of explains it.